You know what?
No, she's bringing me. To cheat. I'm not, I think it's a, it's chained, so I think they're onto something which they're not seeing. She tried to convince me, and oh, it's just this one area and within this restaurant thing. Okay? I don't know, it's something. What's the high park?
Just like a small paragraph on it, just to see if you agree with it.
they have their hands washed on the
camera. I just picture Woods looking at this for real this
Okay, so I think we can start. So we're talking today about a type of corporate reorganization, which has many uses. So it's multifaceted, and it exemplifies the point I made a while ago about these transactions being, or rather these provisions being seen instrumentally, right? So once you sort of understand the core issues, the sort of interest to be protected, once you sort of understand that, and you then proceed to focus on the instrumental uses of these provisions, then you'll be able to, in a sense, make them malleable and deploy them in the service of a multitude of end results that your client may want. And this also demonstrates a point I've made repeatedly, that even when you look at books on corporate finance, the law described in the books is very much different from the law we see in action. So for instance, as you would have gathered if you've checked Gulliver, and that Gulliver and Payne's book is the latest book on corporate finance law. And say, if you check paragraph 5.43, they deal, the two authors deal with reduction of capital in that solitary paragraph, and yet we're talking about maybe 22 pages on this, and these are not, it's not a gratuitous thing. It's because it's important in practice, as you would gather. And that's what I really want to talk about. In addition to that, I would, from time to time, there's a point where we'll look at some transaction documents to see how they are combined. So sometimes, so you'd see transaction documents where different, different aims behind using this structure is pretty much evident. And just to, perhaps maybe I'll show you that. So I mentioned, I think, two two or so in your seminar sheets, but I've actually provided more, which you can look at later on. So if we take, let's just take the ADF deal. So here, it's a share capital reorganization. So what we've done is to demystify this word. What exactly is a share capital reorganization? That's why I provided a taxonomy of share capital reorganizations, to tell you the possible types of share capital reorganizations. So let me just take you there to this before going there, just to remind you. Right, so I said a general context, and I said that let's situate the subject within share capital reorganizations, right, of which there are many kinds. So that's really where we're starting, because obviously we looked at the transaction document of first, and we saw the share capital reorganization. What type of share capital reorganization, we don't know until we sort of look further down. Having said that, let's just look at the taxonomy and then see how to situate it. So there's the consolidation or subdivision. I'll talk about this later on. We've kind of met this earlier. We probably are used to subdivisions, what you call, what the Americans call share splits. So when the share becomes too heavy, you split it, right? And people in corporate finance, people who do corporate finance in business schools, spend a lot of time, working out where the added value comes from. Because, you know, if you look at the empirical results, when you do a share split, the value that is realized from the sum exceeds the previous value. So if you had a share of £100 before and you did a share split, and then they start trading for, let's say, 51 each. So where did that extra come from? Right? It wasn't there before. Why would that suddenly make it come? So people sort of do that. But, so we're kind of used to that. And that's what a subdivision is. But a consolidation is something. I think we came across a consolidation earlier when we looked at, you remember the company which had, if I recall correctly, the company which had shares and it wanted to reduce the par value, right? Because they needed to issue shares to somebody and they didn't want to breach the par value rule. And then they did a consolidation. So we'll come to that. But that's and then remember, I'm just giving you an overview. Then you have this, a reconversion of stock into shares. The reason under the old law, it was way back, certainly before the 2006 Companies Act, you could actually convert shares into stock. So, say 100 shares or 1,000 shares into stock. Now, that has been prohibited. So because it's now been prohibited, there are a lot of companies that are reconverting old stock back into shares, right? So sometimes you come across this. That's why you get this. So if you look under section 620, a company may reconvert existing stock back into paid up shares. So that's one type. Denomination is where you're trying to change your basically the currency of your share capital, right? And I'm sure we're going to be. This actually is quite common, right? So here you're basically trying to change, let's say, USD share capital into a pound sterling capital or vice versa. Then the other one would be increase of share capital, right? We came across this when we were talking about capital structure, where we talked about who controls capital structure. And remember the issues there? The issues are authority, who has authority to issue, preemption rights, right? Remember we talked about Section 551, authority to issue preemption rights and market structures, i.e., what what market participants, players, basically legislate in terms of soft law, right? And all that, right? So that's where increase of share capital comes in. And then reduction of share capital. Now, that's what we're doing today, right? Reduction of share capital. So that's a type of share capital reorganization. And of course, share buybacks, which we've talked about. And then redemption of shares, which is another one. Okay, so now let's go back to this one. So we know now it's a share capital reorganization, but and it says here, authority for the purchase of ordinary shares by the company. So clearly there's a share buyback going on, right? Right? So it's saying, we want to do a share capital reorganization, we want to do a share buyback, and whatever. So let's look at, do you have a question? No, this document is not. They're two simple documents. The reason I decided to add this is that it packs in a number of things, and that's the point I was trying to illustrate, right? So remember I said I uploaded a few documents, that's two, which basically speak to the issues we're dealing with today. I then said, but in a lot of cases in practice, people tend to combine a number of things together. And I thought that would be a good way to illustrate this issue, right? So that's why I'm going through it. Later I'll upload it, right? Okay. There's methods to my madness. okay. So here we say, so let's just look at the story here. The board is proposing to carry out a reorganization of company share capital, right? And increase its distributable reserves. And so we're going to discover today, as you would have seen from the other documents on Keats, that one way you increase your distributable reserves is through a reduction of capital, right? So when you kind of look at it from, if you look at it the typical textbook way, when a textbook writer is talking about a reduction of capital, they're talking like policemen. Oh, thou shalt not do this, thou shalt not do this, thou shalt not do this, right? This is the law. And the law, you sort of cut and paste some sections, and if you're lucky, you get a case, you throw it at that. But we're basically saying, actually, no, we use it instrumentally, right? We use it to make our clients happy, right? To increase their ability to pay out a dividend. And then it says here that, so it talks about ADRs. Then it says to avoid diluting shares, the board proposes to effect a share buyback. It says here, as the company currently has significant retained accumulated losses, it will be necessary for the company to effect a share capital reduction in order to restructure the balance sheet. Right? So you can see, the company, remember the test on distributable profit, section 830, 831, we look at realized accumulated. So here the company, even if the company is making profits, the company has accumulated losses that's weighing it down. So they want to get rid of that so that they can resume paying dividends, right? And we're going to look at the balance sheet entries to do this. And then it says, it is also proposed that the company effects a share consolidation, right? So that's another type of share capital reorganization, which we just talked about. Remember, the share capital consolidation is the opposite of a subdivision, right? So why is it doing this? It's saying in order to increase marketability. So obviously, it must be that there are too many shares. This is one possibility, right? Too many shares in the market. Remember the last one we did, it wasn't a case of too many shares, it was a case of the market price was below par, right? So what you needed to do was solve that problem. In some of the cases, if it's marketability issues, there are too many shares, it's creating pricing issues. So here they say to increase the marketability by creating a higher trading price, so obviously you consolidate, you have a higher trading price, the par value will remain the same, right? But that's why the par value always remains the same, right? But by consolidating, you create a higher price, right? So notice they've packed in quite a lot in here. So here, they're saying we need shareholder approval for the share consolidation, for the capital reduction, which we're talking about today, and also to authorize the company to make market purchases, i.e. to do a share buyback. So you can see how all the various things we've come across are being brought in, right, here. So now, on that note, let's go back to the reduction of capital. Does anybody have any questions so far? Okay, no questions. Okay. So remember, the idea was just to give you an overview of these possibilities. So within that context, we're now focusing on a reduction of capital. And so I start here with the statement of Lord Justice Millett, in this case, the Reed Northern Engineering case. And if we just sort of unpack what he says that that the reduction of any part of your capital, right? Now, you see, when he says nominal capital, I quibble with that because that may mislead. Then you'll be focusing on just par value. But actually, it's anything, isn't it? So it's not just, you know, because, I mean, if you look further down and you use a reduction of capital to sort of release surplus assets. You're paying money back to people and all that. You're not. It's not like you're affecting par value. You're just giving, right? So we've got to be careful. Sometimes you see this with the judges, and that's why we've got to be very precise. So the reduction. So let's just say the reduction of any part of capital, whether I like this, whether paid up or not. Basically just means it's wide, right? Whether or not accompanied by a return to the shareholders, right? While the companies are going concern, because obviously if the company is in liquidation, then that's fine, right? You know, then you just have the usual ladder that you pursue, so you follow or you climb. So he says, generally this requires a confirmation of court. Now, you're gonna see in this seminar that this is no longer there. You know, necessarily the case. We now have the possibility of doing a reduction of capital without going to court by means of a solvency statement. And then he says, you know, the reason for this is that it reduces the protection to creditors, right? And I think in the last class, somebody was talking about the PCP as a possible reduction of capital. I can't remember, there was a lady in class who raised that point. I think it was you, wasn't it? You? Okay, it wasn't you. There's somebody there who referred to the PCP, and it kind of got me excited where she said that the PCP, the way she sees it, is a reduction of capital. And I said, yes, it definitely is, and that's a point. So for some reason, I was attributing credit to you. So that's why, and that's why I put it that way. I was hoping, when I was writing, I was like, oh, she'll be happy when she reads this. So anyway, in our last class, we noticed that reduction of capital could be undertaken in the form of a permissible capital payment to shareholders. So that's what we did under Section 710. Now, I now say here that we're dealing with a general provision. We're going beyond that, right? That said, 710 is limited to that. We're dealing with a general provision, which applies to private companies, applies to public companies, as well as unlimited companies. And that's what we're going to do. So obviously we've now situated it within whatever context that you know that we're talking about. So we now turn to the law. So first of all, the methods and reasons. Methods and reasons. I start with a sort of high-level summary of the changes introduced by the new law. So, and the reason I say this is that when you read some of the old cases, right, just to be aware that, you know, so now, so I mean, we talked about Lord Justice Millet, where he says you go to court, right? The new law says you don't need to go to court, right? And that's pretty significant, because a big safeguard for creditors, in a sense, has been removed, right? Obviously, on pain of punishment of the directors, you could go to jail for 12 months. If you make a false declaration in a solvency statement, right? We have the solvency statement, and we're going to talk about the Sequana case. The Sequana case is a new case where you see the courts grappling with the solvency statement. And because I thought it was really important, I did get some extracts from the case for your seminar document, right? Previously you needed to have authority in your articles to do a reduction of capital. Now you don't, right? Because there's a default rule. And then lastly, remember I talked about the statement of capital. There has to be a statement of capital filed with a registrar. So those are the three broad things. A solvency statement that may send you to jail for 12 months if you lie. We're going to look carefully at the solvency statement and the context of the Sequana case, and then the second one is the default rule, and then the last one is the fact that you need to incorporate it in your statement of capital. So what are the methods and reasons? Why do we do it? So here, I thought this is really one of the most important aspects of this seminar document, right? To not see it simply as a prohibitory provision, but to think about it instrumentally and feel confident to use it. So I start obviously by saying that with respect to limited liability companies, because obviously if it's an unlimited company, then there's no fear, right? If it's unlimited, if the shareholders have unlimited liability, then, you know, you can reduce your capital, you know, it doesn't really matter, right? Because the creditors anyway can always come and grab your private property anyway, so we don't need any kind of safeguards there. Therefore, we're focusing for present purposes on limited liability companies. That's not to say that unlimited companies are not relevant, because think about it. If there's an unlimited liability company and you do a reduction of capital, which is discriminatory, right? So all of us are shareholders in an unlimited liability company, and then we say, well, we're going to cancel some shares, and we take the folks we don't like, right? So the folks here, not that I don't like you, but I'm just, so we cancel your shares. You're not going to be too happy, right? Then what will happen? You will go to court. So notice now, the argument is no longer about creditors, because that doesn't count. It's about discrimination, right? It would be about discrimination. And this is why you will find symmetry in the case law in this context and Section 994, which deals with minority oppression, which is interesting. Because when people think about capital, it's like many chapters far, far away from minority shareholder oppression. Capital deals with creditors. We only deal with creditors. Suddenly, in the case law on capital, we see the judges talking about things using the language courts use in 994, many chapters away. Why? They're using it because it's the same problem. It's oppression, right? A group, and when we look at, there's a case called the Stevens. Yeah, when we look at the Stevens case, you'd see this point coming across. You'd see the judges saying that, you know, you cannot discriminate, right? So remember now, I was just talking about unlimited companies. Obviously, that problem could also arise in limited companies, but I just thought I should flag that up. So, okay, so we're talking about companies limited by shares, and I said there's a dual regime. The dual regime is you go to court or you go and use a solvency statement. So the first is a quarter-proof reduction of capital, which was what Millet was talking about, and the second one is a reduction of capital supported by a solvency statement. Then here, just I talk about unlimited companies, and I obviously show that they're free to reduce their share capital without doing either. Then I said the only question that will be relevant is whether the reduction is constitutional, right? So the, and within that context of is it constitutional, i.e., is it constitutional? Is it discriminatory, right? Because we assume that discriminatory conduct is not constitutional. And that's why the shareholders will go to court to say, why are you removing me? You're discriminating. It's not constitutional. Now, so let's look at the reasons, because I kind of put them in bullet points, right? So the very first one is distributable reserves. We want to increase distributable reserves. In other words, we want to create legal profits. I introduced the idea, we talked about legal capital. There is something called legal profit. Legal profit is the kind of profit you make without toiling. you don't need to work too hard, and it just comes. Initially we came across it when, in cases like Dimbula, the Dimbula estates, where you simply take an asset at book value and revalue it and create a paper profit, right? And then distribute it. Right? So that was a legal profit. That's one example. Of course, now we've blocked that by saying that you can't just revalue an asset and declare a profit. It has to be a realized profit. The second type of, can you guess the other type of legal profit? Profit without sweat. Magic profit. Can you think of another one? Share premium. Huh? You issue shares above par, again, and then you book it to your profits, right? But we've blocked that with Section 610, which says that if you issue shares above par, you put that in the share premium account. Then the third one is through a reduction. Because I'll tell you something, there was a case that came up with this idea, and people were struggling with it. So there's a case called Recuil Monroe, a Scottish case where there's money, well, not money, there's a figure in the share premium account, and the company basically goes to the court to say, we want to do a reduction of capital. And a reduction of capital can also apply to the share premium account, right? So when we say a reduction of capital, you can do it to the share capital account or the share premium. So imagine there was like $1 billion or £1 billion in the share premium. They say to the court, please, can you do a reduction, cancel it? And then they cancel it. And then they say, wow, we've basically achieved a profit. That's what they said. We've achieved a profit. And the court agreed. The court basically agreed that this was a profit. The court said, if we take something which is in a share premium account and we cancel it, we remove it from the share premium account, then there are only two categories. It must be a profit. You understand? It must be profit. Now the mistake there, the court is right, it's profit. But the court was wrong in saying it's distributable, because the court, in a sense, wrongly conflates the recognition of profit, which is an accounting issue, with the distributability question. So saying that we've cancelled the share premium account and we recognize $1 billion as profit, yeah, that's correct. Just like we do with Dimbula, we recognize the increase as profit, but is it distributable? To decide whether it is distributable, it's a legal issue. We don't leave it to the accountants. We go to the law. And the law says it is only distributable if it is a realized profit. Right? So do you get the point? So assuming there is a figure standing to your share premium account and you basically said, let's convert it into some kind of legal profit. If the court, so this is the mistake with Quill Monroe, if the court does not make an assessment of realizability and simply says, yes, it's distributable, then there's a mistake. But the court is correct in saying that once you free something from share premium, right? Once you free it from share premium and you're not capitalizing it in your share capital, then it must be profit. So when Raquel Monroe made this point, people have some difficulty with it. Some of them said, well, it's, in Scotland, they don't know what they're doing, and, that kind of talk. But anyway, in the end, the accountants, when they issued their urgent issue task force document, supported it. And now the law has recognized this. So when you do a reduction of capital, share premium account, it will be regarded as profit. And if the court does not impose some kind of undertaking, then it will be regarded as distributable, right? So in a sense, the court now has the ability to say, I don't think it should be distributable, and therefore I want some kind of undertaking from you. I'll break this down. Let's look at it this way. I said now, so even if you didn't understand anything I was saying, you will understand now. So by now I said it should be obvious to you that the size of a company's distributable reserves is of tremendous importance in corporate finance transactions. It enables a company to decide whether or not to implement a share buyback or pay a dividend. Right? So I said you will see that companies do not need to wait to acquire sufficient assets to constitute enough distributable reserves, because a company can create distributable reserves. Then I said, consider the case of Quill Monroe. I said, this is a case which allowed the share premium to be cancelled, and the reserves that arose on the cancellation were now treated as distributable profits. So they went to court. They didn't say, we're capitalizing the share premium account, right? Which means you take the figure from the share premium account, add it to share capital, and create bonus shares. They didn't say that. They say, we are cancelling it, right? And because we're cancelling it, the reserve which arises should be treated, right, as a distributable profit. Now, I'm saying the correct thing would be to say, we treat it as profit, because legally, accounting-wise, everything must be profit, but it is not distributable, because you've not made a conclusion as to whether or not it is realized. And we know that before a profit is distributed, it has to be realized, i.e. convertibility to cash. So I'm referring to Quill Monroe, right? And you'll see how the law has sort of, in a sense, moved. But the reason I wanted you to, so don't get bogged down by, the distributability question at this point. Just bear in mind that when you cancel your share premium account, you can create profit, right? So if we look further down, I say, here, a company may have sizable accumulated realized profits, but if it has substantial accumulated realized losses, then this will stand in its way when it comes to paying a dividend, right? We know this. So I say, in this sense, accumulated realized losses can block a company when it comes to paying a dividend, even though the company may be trading profitably, right? You are weighed down, as we say, when couples talk, it's got too much baggage, right? So you're weighed down by the baggage of your accumulated losses. And if we look at this deal, which is on Keats, let's look at this. So this is fairly recent, September last year. So what's the company saying? Avast, leading cybersecurity provider, basically is saying we want to do do a capital reduction of the share. So notice a proposed capital reduction, and I said a capital reduction could be of the share capital or share premium account, right? So a proposed capital reduction of the company's share premium accounts, and a proposed cancellation of non-voting subscriber shares, right? We're concerned with the first one. And let's see why. So it says here, the company is proposing in relation to the capital reduction to reduce the amount standing to the credit of the company's share premium, right, by 138 million in order to create distributable reserves. Right? You can see they're saying we're doing this to create distributable reserves. And why? Because we want to be able to support the future payment of dividends to shareholders, as well as being able to do a share buyback. Right? And you see the directors basically saying they consider that both the capital reduction are likely to promote the success of the company for the benefit of the company, the shareholders as a whole. So basically referencing the Section 172 duty. So here you've seen a transaction document saying this. Now my point basically, this is the point I'm making, is that if you take Quill Monroe, right, which basically explained, you know, I'll tell you what Quill Monroe did. There's logic here. Quill Monroe basically says, if we go back in time, when people used to issue shares at a premium, what was the nature of that premium before statute came in? Profits, right? So if there was a premium, right, something above par, if it wasn't capital, it must be profit. That's the logic. So you then kind of fast forward. We now have a share premium account. And we're saying, let's cancel it. Let's capitalize it, let's cancel it. So if we cancel it and we release it, then it cannot surely be capital, it must be profit. Do you see, that's the logic, that's what Quill Monroe did. It must be profit. Now, the slight error, or big error, as you, depending on how you say it, was that Quill Monroe then says, well, and therefore it's distributable. And I say, no, it's not distributable, because the law doesn't say you distribute profit, the law says you distribute a distributable profit, which turns on realization. Right? Okay. So, now, but the point here then is that, I said there's a new statute, right, which I will talk about, which recognizes what Quill Monroe does, but simply says, well, you know, the judge should have the ability to make an undertake, to require an undertaking if they have concerns about realizability, right? So based on that, this company now says, we want to do that, right? We want to basically transform our share premium into profit. That's what the company is doing. And then also look at this one, Anglo-Asian Mining PLC. So operational performance have been transformed over the past 4 years as a result of dynamic management. Now the company had negative distributable reserves, but management thought that, you know, the prospects of the company are good. And so management takes the view that it was appropriate to undertake a capital reduction and create distributable reserves, which will enable the company pay dividends in future. So if we look at the Anglo-Asian document. So here, look at the letter the directors are writing. I'm writing with details of a proposal to enhance the company's ability to pay dividends in the future. The company has negative distributable reserves and is therefore prohibited under the Act from making distributions. So if you were the lawyer and you simply said, well, sorry, you can't make a distribution because you have negative distributable reserves, and then another lawyer comes and says, yes, that's a law, but I can create things for you. Who's going to be paid more? Who's going to get more work? You know? So that's the issue, all right? Okay. Accordingly, approval is being sought to carry out a reduction of the company's capital by way of cancellation of the amount standing to the credit of the share premium account so as to create distributable reserves, right? And then you see how... when you read this, you see how it then deals with this. It talks about the capital reduction. So let's just look a bit closer at the capital reduction here. The proposal, hope you can see, no, it's a bit. So look at the second paragraph. The company has retained losses of 18.5 million. At the same date, the amount standing to the credit of the company's share premium account amounts to 32 mil. And then it says as at 31st May, the amount standing to the credit of share premium account remained at 32, and retained losses increased to 19 mil. The capital reduction, if approved and made effective, will be sufficient to eliminate the retained losses and create distributable reserves. So the capital reduction is proposed to be effected by cancelling the balance standing to the credit of the share premium account. Remember, I always say the share premium account does not contain money. It's just an accounting entry. You're going to cancel the balance standing to the credit of the share premium account. Then cancelling the balance will, notice, subject to the undertakings required by the court as explained below. Remember I talked about the undertakings? Right? Be sufficient to eliminate the deficit on the retained loss account and create positive distributable reserves. Notice now they use the word distributable reserves. Why is it distributable? Because of the undertakings. Right? They found a way around Quail Monroe. Right? So, or rather the problem of Quail Monroe. As a result, any positive distributable reserves generated by the company after the date on which the capital reduction takes effect would also be available to the board to use to pay dividends. Right? So that must be clear. So the slight problem with Quail Monroe, as I said, has been dealt with through this undertaking, and we see this here. If you look at the statutory instrument which was passed in 2008, so here I say the Quail Monroe decision has now been codified, and the consequence of this is that the reserve arising from the reduction will be treated as a realized profit unless the court orders otherwise, right, so through the undertakings, huh? And that's where we have the 2008 SI/1915, right, doing that. So that's one reason. We've given one reason. So if you have a problem question and you get this long story about it, now you know how, at least you know the reason why we can do this. So we'll go to another one. Another reason why you'll do a reduction of capital is because the company has surplus assets and no plan to deploy them reasonably well. So the company has surplus assets, yeah.
Is the realized profit means the distributable?
That's right. It's distributable. That's right, yeah. So there are many, I mean, take in America when Donald Trump, you know, whatever people think about Donald Trump, he economics-wise, you know, he's doing a great job, right? Reducing, you know, changing the tax code, creating jobs, blah, blah, blah. I don't like the guy, but, you know, the economics just makes sense to me, right? So one thing he does, right, he knows a lot of American companies have a lot of money abroad. He thinks about how do we get this money back, right? And what he does is change the tax code, and guess what? Money starts coming. A lot of money starts coming in. And you think I watch Fox News, you know, anyway. So a lot of money starts coming in, and the companies are flush with cash. What do? Activist shareholders are saying, give us the money, because you can't really deploy the capital at a level which would exceed your weighted average cost of capital. You don't really have great ideas, right? So give us the money. So the company has the surplus cash. What does it do? A reduction of capital could be one. Because one thing, though, you may not want to sort of create an unsustainable dividend history, right? So if you go down the dividend route, you'll be setting yourself up for failure, right? Because you pay a big dividend, then later the market says, oh, you know, the directors are not performing well, blah, blah, blah. You know, it could also affect many other things in terms of incentive packages and all that. So you go down the reduction of capital route. So that's one. Another one could be that you're planning to make a takeover. Under UK takeover rules, you've got to get your funding in place, right? So imagine you get the funding in place, and then the takeover does not work. So you have a lot of money. What do? So imagine it's a bond issue. You've already drawn down, and you know, so you have surplus capital. So you want to get rid of it. Also because the surplus capital could be attractive to a takeover bidder, right? And who you don't want. So, and I give this example here. So a typical example would be a company which wishes to take over a company. Assuming the takeover does not materialize, in that situation, the company will have excess cash without any real plans about how to utilize them. In this kind of scenario, the company would use a reduction of capital to repay paid up capital, right? And I said in this scenario, the reduction, unlike the previous one, will stream the cash to the shareholders without any need to create a reserve. Do you see? So the other one, you're creating a reserve. Here, you're streaming the cash to shareholders without any need. Right? Under this head, the company may also use capital reduction to release a liability on the part of a shareholder to pay up unpaid share capital. So you know, when we talk about paying for shares, so imagine you have a problem question. Other people pay for shares. This other guy doesn't pay for shares, right? And then the company now says, okay, you know what? We're going to find a way around it to release his liability. And then they ask you, and you say, oh, no, this is unlawful and all that. You can't do it. And somebody else says, well, you can if you go down the reduction of capital route, right? To say, can we release him from this liability to pay up shares, right? Because you can, right? Remember, go back to what Millett talked about when he says, you know, a reduction of capital takes many forms. It could be giving somebody something. It could be releasing somebody from an obligation to pay for his shares. Yeah.
I don't really understand the stream of cash to shareholders without any need to create a reserve.
So here the company already has distributed reserves. That's not the issue.
Yeah.
So the company then has this excess cash, right? So the company, it's not fixated then on creating a reserve. It is simply saying, I have excess cash. I want to give it to the shareholders.
Can you just pay the
dividend?
Yeah.
But what you said earlier, I talked about this earlier, I said you don't want to create a dividend history.
Yeah, I didn't understand that.
Oh, okay, sorry. Okay. Because, human beings kind of judge people by the past, you know. So, and you're only as good as, you know. So it's like, okay, these guys are doing very well. They paid this big dividend. Next year, they're not paying a big dividend. That means they're not good. Right? Okay. Management, they don't like that. So you don't want to create what they call an unsustainable dividend history. If you can't, so that's why most companies try to manage their dividend. We'll talk about the economic theory on dividends and the signaling effect. You don't want to give the wrong signals and all that. Okay, so, and then another transactional use is in the context of a buyback or redemption of shares, right? So we know that, so we're not going to talk about that. But let's look at this. We can use it in the context of a demerger, right? We can use it in the context of a demerger. And I give an example here. If you look at, I think there's a Liberty or so, I give an example. And I'd like us to look at that. Let me be clear about the reasons, and then we'll look at the measure. So here we say, I give the example. I said, consider a company that has distinct businesses with different risk and reward profiles, and therefore different capital requirements. So the company would take the view that, okay, we're running hotels and we're selling arms, they don't fit, let's just split them. So how do we split them? We use a demerger. Or rather, we do a demerger. But how do we do a demerger? We use a reduction of capital. Essentially, what will happen is we'll create a new company, transfer maybe the hotel business to that new company, right? So we'll literally transfer the land, property, hotels, everything to that new company. And then that new company will issue shares to your shareholders. Technically, that is a reduction of capital. It's a return of capital. It's a reduction of capital. You'll see how it works, because I'm going to use an example. So here, I said the demerger will be structured as a reduction of capital, involving the return of capital to members. How is that return of capital to be done? It is satisfied by the issue of new shares in the new company to which the assets at the hotel business would have been returned to members, would have been transferred. So instead of giving the hotels to the members directly, you give the hotels to this company, and then that company gives the members shares, right? Let me take you to a case that actually does this, so that we can see an example.
In that case, would the shares be issued to the already existing shareholders, or would it be a new subsidiary of the company?
No, so the new company will issue its shares. The subsidiary, the new company, will issue its shares to the shareholders of the old company.
So
there's one company already, right? There's one company already. That one company then creates another company, right? And then starts transferring assets to that company. But then that new company then issues all its shares to the shareholders of the first company, so that you end up with a situation where when you finish the deal, the shareholders of the new company own this company totally, right? And therefore the assets, right? And so in economic terms, what has really happened is that you've returned things to them through the medium of this company. Yeah.
Transfer of the assets, is that the consideration for the shares, or do you actually have to pay the shares?
So essentially when you're doing the the merger, you're basically saying that, okay, I will capitalize the new company through the reduction of capital. Right? So assuming it's your Shepherdmin account, in the case of Liberty, and I was trying to use that example because that was a very good one. Let me actually get the Liberty case because that really illustrates it. I noticed that I was focusing on just one aspect there, and I just want to. So I think the Liberty case. Yeah. Okay. So here you would see, what's it? Okay. I'll open the case later, but I'm just sort of breaking it down. So before I open the case, the board of Liberty decides that they're distinct businesses. It decides to demerge them. So the demerger has been structured using a reduction of capital, which involves a return of capital to members, which is satisfied by the issuance of new shares in the new company, to which the assets, which would otherwise have been given to the members, has been given to, right? Given it to this new company. The new company is called Capco. The return of capital is achieved by the cancellation of the share premium account. It stands at about £1 billion, and the issue to each holder of a Liberty share, so your existing shareholders, of one new share in Capco. Right, so that's a structure. And the judge is saying that I'm satisfied that the resolutions affecting the reductions have been validly effected, that the Liberty shareholders have been treated equitably. Remember the other time I was talking about treating people fairly, not getting rid of them, right? The proposals have been explained to them. The reduction is for a readily discernible purpose. And that's the case. Okay, that's okay. Here I abbreviated this, so I'll just So that's the full case. So essentially, the return of capital, you can see in paragraph 3 here, it's achieved by the cancellation of the share premium account, right? And the issue to each holder of a Liberty share, so each shareholder in Liberty, of a new share in Capco. Now, the net asset value of the assets comprising Capco's business is $730 million. The size of the proposed cancellation exceeds this, and this will lead to a creation of a reserve sufficiently large to support the merger. And then you see here the judge basically saying, the essential requirements which I talked about, right? So through the cancellation of the share premium account, and the fact that the shareholders have received value in there, you tick the consideration box. There is consideration, right? Because the shareholders are getting value there. The company itself has received an asset. And all you've just done is eject shareholders. All you've just done, essentially, is find a way to give shareholders those assets by ejecting them from your company and giving them those assets in another company. That's essentially what you've done. I thought the Liberty case was good because we rarely see these things in practice when people talk about, you know. So, and I thought the Liberty, and the reason why the Liberty case went to court was because there was an issue about creditor interest which hadn't been dealt with. Now, I'm mindful that we have so much to cover, so I think I've just dealt with the demerger. Then the other one would be a transfer of assets owned by the community shareholders directly. And then you may use a reduction of capital. Yes, this one I'd like to talk about this, especially for those people who have the scheme of arrangement. So if you're from Singapore, Hong Kong, the reason I say this is that the scheme of arrangement, there are two types of schemes of arrangements as far as members are concerned. Right. If you do insolvency, you'll know that you can use a scheme of arrangement to deal with creditors, right? In fact, that's how it started. And then later on, we then began to use it with members. Now, I call a scheme of arrangement a tool of corporate engineering, right? It's a tool of corporate engineering because it allows us to do many things. And so we could use it to do a takeover. And in the past, one thing we used to do was to save on stamp duty. Because, when you do a takeover and there's a transfer of shares, you pay stamp duty on the transfer, right? So you pay stamp duty on the transfer of shares in any legal system, right? Okay. So what you want to do to find a way around that is to take over the company without a transfer of shares. And that's what the scheme of arrangement basically did. So essentially what it did was that you would propose the scheme to the target shareholders and say to the target shareholders that I want to take over your shares, but I don't want you to transfer your shares to me. Instead, I just want your shares to disappear. Let's just cancel your shares. So all your shares get cancelled. And when your shares get cancelled, then you have nothing. So what happens to you? The moment your shares are cancelled, you are ejected from your company, and assuming I'm going to give you shares in my company, right? It could be cash, but let's imagine I'm giving you shares in my company. You become members of my company because I issue shares to you. So the consideration for the cancellation of your shares in your company is that you become shareholders in my company. And then, so the share capital, the moment share capital was cancelled in your company, it went to zero, isn't it? And then I then go into your company and the share capital goes back because the shares are now issued to me. All this has been achieved without any transfer. So literally I now control your company with no transfer, with not paid tax. Right? So, and this has been going on for a long, long time, right? And if you look at most parts of the Commonwealth, if they're clued off enough, they do this. But recently, the government then said, we're going to cancel that bit. We're going to block cancellation schemes. Remember during the Starbucks, remember the time when there was this big outcry that Starbucks is not paying tax, or not tax, Amazon, Apple, you remember? So the government was under some kind of pressure. So the government basically said that we're going to block this, right? And so the way they blocked it was to say you can no longer do cancellation schemes to do a takeover. So technically, in the UK, you can no longer use a scheme of arrangement to do a cancellation scheme to save on tax. You can still use a scheme of arrangement, right, to do a takeover, what we call a transfer takeover, transfer scheme, but you can't use it to save on tax. Now, the reason I put it here is that when you do a scheme of arrangement involving a cancellation scheme, a reduction of capital is part of it. So you're combining a scheme of arrangement with a reduction of capital. Because when you tell your shareholders we're cancelling your shares, it's a reduction of capital. You see? So when we say to the shareholders we're cancelling your shares, that's a reduction of capital. Now the government has blocked that bit. So if you're from, Hong Kong, you'll go back and you'll still do it the way you used to do it, right? This seminar notes will be useful to you. You'll do it the way. if you're from this jurisdiction, you've got a problem. You've got a problem because the fact that the government has blocked that aspect of the transaction, does it mean it has blocked every other thing? That's the next question. That's the next question. Here, I say, so after talking about the way you could combine a reduction of capital with a scheme of arrangement, right? So notice, just to remind you, I said using this method, the shares in the target company are cancelled. When you cancel the shares in the target company, that's a reduction of capital. Hmm? This cancellation is in effect a reduction of capital to zero and reissued to the bidder. So the shares which are cancelled, which we don't want you to transfer, because that's what we're trying to avoid, are now issued to the bidder, to me. Meanwhile, you guys are now in my company. In consideration for the bidder's shares, blah, blah, blah. Then I say the reserve created by the cancellation, and the target company following the reduction is then applied in paying up for shares, blah, blah, blah. Then I say this route has now been blocked. So the question I pose here, which is a live one, is to what extent will this prohibition... So what's the prohibition? The blocking of the reduction to zero. Are we clear? Do you get it? What has been blocked by the government is the reduction of capital, right? The reduction of capital, right, the cancellation to zero, that allows me as a bidder to get rid of you guys and the target so that you guys end up in my company and I end up as the controller of your company without there being a transfer of shares. You see, when we do reduction to zero, when we cancel your shares, there is no transfer of shares. And if there's no transfer of shares, we don't pay tax. That is what has been blocked by the government. So my question then is, if that bit has been blocked and we do a reduction of capital, could it be argued, so not a reduction of capital to take over a company now, just any other reduction of capital, for whatever purpose, is there a risk that this block could affect what we're doing? You see, because by now you know that we use a reduction of capital to do many things, so many things. What if tomorrow you come up with a scheme, you come up with a transaction for your clients, and you combine the reduction of capital with it, it's not to evade tax or anything or to avoid tax, and there's a reduction to zero, and then you then discover that we have this legislation which the government has just introduced that blocks things. So the question then is, would that become a problem for you? Now, I tell you why this is real. In tax, in statutory interpretation, there's something called the Ramsey Principle. I don't know if you're aware of the Ramsey Principle. So normally when we interpret laws, when we interpret, let's say, fiscal legislation, tax legislation, before Ramsey, we don't look at the purpose of the legislation, right? We simply adopt a linguistic approach. And any structure you create, like a company, a debt, a credit, we take individually. We don't sort of say, what's going on here? What are these wise guys trying to do? We don't do that, right? Normally. Then the Ramsey case, and says, we're changing this. We will look, whenever we're dealing with tax legislation, we're going to look at the purpose of what you're doing. And therefore, we will try to connect things, right? So, if that is the case, the question then is, could the Ramsey Principle unravel many transactions we're doing because of this new law which blocks one thing? Right? That's the issue. So I said, the Companies Act 2006 amendment, part 17, to what extent will this prohibition, we've identified a prohibition, right, the cancellation of the share of the capital account, that's the prohibition, right? To what extent will this affect transactional practice? And just to remind you here, again, of the prohibition, before I go into the analysis, I said the regulations amended section 641 to prohibit a company from reducing its share capital as part of a scheme of arrangement where the purpose of the scheme is to acquire all the shares of the company. Right? That's the purpose of the new law. So, if that's the purpose of the new law, and I provide the sections here, to what extent will this affect our future transactions, even outside a scheme of arrangement? That's the issue. And I say here, the answer is, it's a question of how far anti-avoidance construction takes us. And I cite a case called the Unilever case, which was decided last year. And the principle of Unilever is this. The principle will not require a cancellation scheme to be prohibited under Section 641 where it is part of a more complex plan. And if the plan falls within the spirit of the exemption in Section 641(2)(b) and the steps are inserted for genuine commercial reasons. If you look at 641(2)(b), right, if you look there, you would see, when you, I don't want to spend too much time on this, but when you look through, you'll see that essentially what this case is saying, the Unilever case, is saying that let us not allow the Ramsey principle, you know, destroy commercial dealings, you know, transactions. If we can make sense of what the people are doing, even if there's a cancellation of the share premium account or share capital account to zero, and it's not part of the scheme of arrangement to take over a company, well, you know, then, you know, let's let it fly. And in fact, to I'll just say this so that it's, this bit should be clear. So if we look at the the background to the Unilever case, right? What's the background? It's what I explained to you earlier. I said the approach to fiscal legislation was one of linguistic analysis. Not to the purpose, linguistic analysis, you look at the words, until the Ramsey case. Now, and what does this mean? It means that every element of a composite transaction which had legal identity is treated as having its separate tax consequences. We don't bundle them together. However, Ramsey changed all of this. And now you take a purposive approach to tax laws. So what was the test with Ramsey? The ultimate question is whether the relevant statutory provisions purposefully construed were intended to apply to the transaction viewed realistically. That's the test. And what you see the court saying, in a case before, I didn't talk about the home retail case because Unilever just builds upon it. What a case in home retail essentially was saying is that we will not allow the Ramsey principle to bite a transaction that you guys do if it's not part of a scheme of arrangement to take over a company. Any other thing, whatever you do, if you put in a reduction of capital to zero and all that, we're not going to apply Ramsey. In other words, what they're saying to us is, you know, business as usual, basically. That's the point, business as usual. We've confined that case. So I'll stop here and we'll take a 10-minute break and then we'll continue. I know it's been a bit heavy, but I think it's better than reading one paragraph in whatever the book is. Anyway, 10 minutes.
Last picture. I understand that why and how the AKM should have gone, but why for 150 for the capture 150?
Yeah, because we just said you can split it. You can either. Let me have a break.
I don't think it's like too much attention. not. It's part of the system. It's not true, is it?
It's the law.
Did you already talk about the second sentence, like the fact that it was for this
woman?
Thank you.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, okay. So I hope you got the last thing. It's it was just it's a quirk of you know, sort of UK tax laws and all that. And but the point, you know, nobody's testing this. But the point I just wanted to make is, I think the larger picture here is that the legal system, you know, there is a sort of judicial philosophy in England, which is that they want it to be business friendly, right? And so, and you see this in the commercial court, you know, most of the disputes being resolved in the UK have no connection whatsoever with the UK, right? So the UK basically wants that to continue, and therefore case law that supports that will always be produced. And that's why you're seeing the courts basically saying, we will not unravel these things, notwithstanding what has been passed, right? Okay. So now we go to the solvency statement, because remember, just to remind ourselves, to do a reduction of capital before the reforms, you just had to go to court, right? And when you went to court, you basically spoke to the court on two things. One, you said, creditors are not affected, and two, it is not discriminatory among shareholders, right? In other words, it's constitutional. I'm respecting shareholder rights. Those were the two things you did. And now the law has changed somewhat by saying that, well, you don't even need to go to court always. So you can choose to go to court, or you can sort of do it in your bedroom, as it were. But if you do it in your bedroom, then make sure you come up with a solvency statement, right? And where you basically you make a statement punishable if it's false, an imprisonment. And the idea basically is to convince to make a statement basically to the effect that creditors will not be impaired, right? We'll be able to pay creditors. And obviously the timing from when you make the statement to when you do it should not be too long, right? So you don't want to sort of, well, you'll see this in a minute. So here we see the Sequana case, talking about it. It says that section 641, now provides two alternative procedures for the company to reduce it. It says a private company can reduce it, supported by a solvency statement. Any company can reduce it by special resolution confirmed by the court. And then it says, 642 describes the circumstances in which a reduction is supported by a solvency statement. The directors must make a statement not more than 15 days before the special resolution, and the requirements for the solvency statement are set out in 643. Right, so the solvency statement essentially contains two opinions of the directors, right? The first is that there is no ground on which the company could then be found unable to pay its debts. That's the first statement. And the second one is that the company will be able to pay its debts as they fall due during the year immediately following the date of the statements. Right? And in making the statement, you need to take account of contingent liabilities, right? So you need to take account of contingent and prospective liabilities. The question is, how far do you go? How far do you go in taking account of these contingent and prospective liabilities? And this is where the Liberty case comes in. Right? Remember I mentioned the Liberty case earlier, and I mentioned the context of a demerger. Right? Is some music playing? Is some... Mm-hmm. Oh, okay. No, I thought somebody was... You know. Okay. So you remember we talked about the Liberty case earlier in the context of a demerger. And then But the Liberty case also tells us something else. It really tells us about this whole notion of prospective and contingent liabilities. Think about it. If you are to sign a solvency statement, if you're to make a solvency statement, and you know that there are some contingent liabilities, would you sign it? That's really the question. Bear in mind, if you get it wrong, you go to jail, right? So that's the question. So in the Liberty case, so I'm going to skip all this and go straight to Liberty case so that we see this. So notice, we're dealing here with creditor interest. Remember I said when a reduction of capital involves two interests, creditors, shareholders. Most times people, when the books talk about reduction of capital, they rarely talk about shareholders' interest, right? It's almost as if people have forgotten this. And what I'm trying to do is bring it to the fore, right? To say, you know, there is an issue. But we've not reached it yet. We're still dealing with creditors' interest. Now, so with creditors' interest, if you go down the solvency statement route, the law basically says that, you know, tell us your opinion about the company being able to pay its debts. Okay, yes, you can say, well, the company doesn't owe, the company can pay its debts, and even debts coming accruing or falling due this year will be able to pay. What if they're contingent and prospective liabilities? This is what this case is about. So, you see the judge saying, this has come to me because of issues relating to creditor protection. So he now turns to that. He now says that basically you need to identify every creditor of the company who is entitled to object, and the law has identified that. Then, so basically, the law basically says that we should be focusing on those who have an entitlement to lodge proof at the date in question. And then, second, proof by the creditor that there's a real likelihood that a reduction itself, so the reduction of capital, would result in the company being unable to discharge the debt when it falls due. Now, so the question then is, what account must be taken of theoretical pension claims when considering who are the creditors entitled to object? So that's the problem. We're setting creditor claims, right? So because the company's pension scheme had a deficit of about $1.9 million, and there was the bottom line here was that yes, there was this prospective liability, but it depended on the discretion of the pension authority. That was the key thing. So because it depended on how the pension authority will exercise its discretion, you see the court taking a different view. Let's look at this. The court says here that there is a well-settled line of authority which establishes that where the imposition of the obligation under which the debtor is made liable depends upon the exercise of some prior discretion, then at the relevant date, the debtor is not subject to any liability. So it's not a contingent debt. Liberty is not at present liable to the trustees or to the pension protection fund. It can only become liable when the pension regulator reaches that finding, exercises its discretion to that effect. And therefore, this is not admissible in proof. Right? So you can see how that becomes relevant when it comes to making your solvency statement. If there's something that depends on discretion, then it's not really, you don't count it. And then, here there are a number of issues addressed. What is the appropriate approach to construction of the provisions setting out the solvency statement? I'm not gonna go there because it's there, right? I want you to go through that. There's no point in me reading what's there. So those are the issues that the Sequana case dealt with, down to what is the correct test, right? You can see I'm skipping all of this because it's there for you, right? And there's an interesting question here. When forming their view on the solvency statement, should the directors assume that all distributable reserves created by the reduction of capital will be distributed by way of dividend? So the fact that you intend to pay dividends, should that affect the solvency statement? Well, again, I'm not going to go in there because it's all there for you to read. Right? So I'd like you to read this the Sequana case dealing with this, because I think it really deals with the solvency statement in a lot of that that you're not going to find anywhere else. And then transaction analysis, we've talked about that, right? We've looked at the transaction analysis. And then we're looking at how the statute is then worded in terms of forms of reduction, right? Now, all I just wanted to flag up here was this. A company, you know, this is how I think we should approach it. You know, when you look at the statute provisions and it says, oh, you can reduce by doing this, by doing that, by doing that, you know, the problem with that is that it limits the way people think. You begin to think only in that way. Whereas the best way to think is just to start with the beginning, which is a company may reduce its share capital in any way. In any way. That means, you know, you define your own sort of universe and do it yourself, right? Rather than be limited by those categories. Right? So that's important. And then the next thing I do is show you the balance sheet entries to create distributable profits, right? So that you can see how this works. So this is the example. How to use a reduction of capital to create distributable profits. So before the reduction, you have accumulated losses of £2 million, right? So your balance sheet shows called up share capital, £3 million, your share premium account, £500,000. Clearly you have a loss in your P&L, right? So that's showing £2 million. So suppose the company wishes to do a reduction of capital to eliminate the £2 million accumulated losses. What it does is do a reduction of capital to cancel paid up capital, right, to the extent of 50p, so half of the £3 million, right, and you cancel the share premium account. So basically, you cancel 50p on each of your £3 million shares. Right? Oh dear. I have 10% left, yeah. So anyway, if you look here, so essentially what we've done, basically, we've taken the call of share capital, we've literally shaved off half, because if we've taken 50p on each, from 3 million, it goes to 1.5, right? But remember, what we want to do is eliminate 2 million. So we look elsewhere, and if this company has if this company has a share premium account of 500,000, and we've already shaved off 1.5 from share capital, then we take that 500,000 from the share premium account, so that the balance sheet will now show a share premium account, which has been taken to zero, called up share capital 1.5. Right, so you've done a reduction of capital, and that's how it will. That's how it will look, right? So essentially, what you've done is you've wiped out your accumulated losses, right? And so here, what I've just done is bring together everything by saying, okay, these are the three routes. You have the court-approved reduction of capital available to private and public companies, right? And here we go back to the Liberty case again, which I'm not going to repeat. Then I say, if you go to court, the court is going to ask the question, do we have, what's the jurisdiction of the court? What does the court look at? Right? So if you go to court and the court is exercising its jurisdiction, now you will get this. I've planted this idea about fairness in your mind, about thinking about shareholders. Now, this is important. Why is it important? It's important because of something we studied earlier, which is shareholder rights configurations. If we have configured share rights, right, so we've designed share rights in a particular way. So imagine, let me use this example. Imagine we have two classes of shares called ordinary shares and preference shares. And the preference shares are exactly the same as the ordinary shares, with only one difference, maybe two differences. The first is in the name, we call it preference shares. And the second is that it has no voting rights. That's the only two, right? So really one difference, no voting rights. Then we now say that we want to do a reduction of capital, right? The company, we need to cancel capital, right? So in this example, you saw how they canceled 2M. So what we then do is to say, we focus on the preference shareholders and say, we're going to cancel the preference shareholders. Do you see anything wrong with that? What?
That you target them only, and that's, I can't remember the section, but it's like their class rights only.
Yeah, so what we've done, when we designed their shares, right, we said they're all equal in regard to capital. They're all equal in regard to income. The only difference is that the guys we call preference shareholders, in my example, do not have voting rights. That's the only difference. They're literally ordinary shareholders, right? They're ordinary shareholders without voting rights. And then, so confusingly, we call them preference shareholders. But the name doesn't mean anything, right? Because you need to specify the rights. So because the rights were not specified, we are all the same as regards capital. So what did we do? We decided to do a reduction of capital, maybe it's a return of capital to expel people. What did we do? Rather than visit it on everybody, we targeted one group. Right? Are you in this class?
This is
company. Oh, yeah. Okay, but, okay, 5 minutes, sir. Okay, we've not finished. This is an LLM class. LLM, yeah. Don't worry, we'll suck it. And then, I'll surround them. So basically, what this means is that when we look at the jurisdiction issue, the issue of fairness, we need to look at the entitlements you bargained for earlier, right? The entitlements you, and then respect those entitlements. So you don't act arbitrarily, you act by reference to what you bargained for earlier, right? I will pick up on this when next we meet, but I'd really like you to read this. And see how this sort of comes together. What you see, following, really just is the detail of what I've been saying. Because I've sort of explained everything to say, you know, these are statute provisions, so it's really the detail. Right? Okay then, thank you. Oh, and by the way, and we have reading week. Okay, so you have enough time to get into it.
I think that's
I'm not.